Professor Perez Diaz has been also part of a project where Jody and myself were involved in the early 2000s, I think 2003 and 2005, mm-hmm. and that was organized and initiated by the Wissenschaftszentrum Berlin für Soziale Wissenschaften. And its name was CISONET. This is what I'm saying, is these were still quite optimistic times. We did believe sociologists and political scientists and some others, philosophers, that there is such a thing like an effective, or there should be or could be such a thing like an effective European civil society, at least cross-border, mm-hmm. cooperatively cross-border civil society. There was a fascinating project and with a lot of promises led by Professor Jürgen Kocka, who actually did visit us in Gösseg a couple of years ago. And so we try as much as we can do to maintain this, at least the idea, the research agenda, and our social and academic network. So you are very, very welcome. Most of our colleagues from IASC, this is the Institute of Advanced Studies, Gösseg, are aware of your work. We circulated your wonderful essays. And I don't think that I need, because we don't have so much time, to give a long introduction about your achievements, but just a few things. People should know that Professor Perez Diaz is chairman of Analistas Sociopoliticos Research Center in Madrid. And he has been a research fellow in the most prestigious universities and advanced study centers of the world, MIT, Harvard University, University of California, University of San Diego, and Wissenschaftszentrum Berlin, and many, many other institutions. Now, maybe it doesn't sound too modest, but I really have to mention that whatever you write is very close to my heart and to my brain. And so in many ways, our way of thinking is very similar. Unfortunately, I was not able to do much work on civil society and democracy in the last 10 years because we have been developing here a new institution. This is not the topic today, but this is what the reason why I'm so interested about your results and the perspectives on the European scale. We have this lecture series started with Aniko Magashazi about 2 or 3 years ago about the future of Europe. And we had some distinguished lecturers, as I saw here, registered Professor Zilionka and Alexander Smolar, with whom also we have been cooperating the early 90s, even the late 80s. So the word is yours. We are very much interested in your Proustian or post-Proustian visions and everything that you are going to tell us. I would suggest a maximum 40, 45 minutes that we can have enough time for questions and discussions. The floor is yours, Victor.
Okay. Welcome. Thank you. Well, good afternoon, dear friends and distinguished scholars. First of all, thanks so much to the Institute of Advanced Study of Gösseg, and in particular to Professors Frank Mislevich and Aniko Magashazi for your kind invitation and your kind words. I feel deeply honored by it and happy to share with you a few thoughts on Europe's prospects and to participate in this conversation the way we may explore a forest, trying to help each other to find our path. I hope, we may be making Europe just by means of conversations not so dissimilar to this one. I anticipate my points, an open drama, the broad goal of a European space for friendship, a Proustian approach to mutual understanding, and a narrative of complex identities. Let's start with some of the topoi many Europeans we may share today. We find ourselves in dramatic circumstances, subject to a combination of pandemia, cum economic crisis, political disarray, disquieting geopolitics, with the emergence of very powerful authoritarian states, a fairly fragmented society, and say cultural restlessness. All of them are challenges to be met by the European Union and its national states, which in turn seem to have both a rather limited capacity to do it successfully. Hence, we may infer there is a middle to high risk for Europe to drift, possibly gradually, to increasing entropy into chaos. Maybe in a mood of alarm, or maybe in the mood of a sort of inertia dulcedo going down and douceur, like the Roman Empire in Tacitus' view, allowing such descent to happen. However, at the same time, we may argue, the next scenes of the drama are still to be written, the outcome of which it is not predetermined. And there is room for us to make our leap of faith out of the maelstrom, in poes figurative, so to speak, room to make a bet, a Pascalian wager of some sort, and try to do better. In other words, are, in my view, very critical situation, may be seen as an opportunity to move forwards, provided we understand it. Understanding, learning, listening. The need to understand highlights the importance of learning by reasoning together, of a civic debate leading to the right decisions and the right action at the right time, a debate all around. Of course, with the main decision makers used to play the center stage of the public space included, but also, and possibly mainly, a debate for the common people, used to apply their common sense approach to the specifics of politics and policy on a daily basis in real life, and without the support of which no sustained policy is possible. No political community is possible either. Also a debate for the kind of, if you allow me this expression, benevolent, enlightened people Leibniz used to refer to just about three centuries ago, as a way to help Europe to get over a long, disastrous period of European and civil, mainly political, partly cultural or religious wars, which we may use as a role model for today's academics and professionals, and us, other variants of spectateur engagé. The very experience of conversing points the way to shape, to remake, to recreate Europe as a space for conversation, and lastly, as a space for friendship, without which, I repeat, no polity may survive. Providing Europe with crucial both long-term and short-term benefits, reinforcing its identity and its strategic capacity, finding direction, and also learning how to proceed step by step. In fact, the very first step of conversing already bear witness to the final destination. The way to achieve a space of conversation and friendship is not so much to define a project and then to outline an ingenious design and then make a strong show of willpower and do it by means of a highly elaborated constitutional text, a number of political commissions, a major information and propaganda campaign, and the ensuing appeal to show up, to vote or demonstrate in the streets. In other words, making Europe requires neither a voluntaristic decisionist project under the banner of More Europe, nor a nominalist postmodern strategy, Europe being what we decide Europe to be. Rather, to achieve a space of conversation and friendship requires to be realistic enough. To begin with, by having a common sense of reality, so to speak. that's to reckon with and learning to handle Europe as it is already, as the provisional yet enduring result of an ongoing experience of choices having been made between different possibilities, and the usual choices between second best and lesser evil, so to speak. Choices to be made and then remembered and reinterpreted again and again. In other words, the way to achieve our goal concerning the future is to try our best at shaping the present while reinterpreting the past, in a way reminiscent of the one Otto Neurath suggested to articulate a theory. Like sailors who have to rebuild their ship in the open sea, without ever being able to dismantle it in dry dock and reconstruct it from the best components. Dealing with a rather contested experience of centuries, an experience with a considerable doses of ambiguity, as it is made out of remembering and forgetting, of mutual care and of self-centered egoism, leading to violence. Thus, learning our cognitive and moral and emotional limits, learning to live with our limits while maybe trying to overcome them, whatever it is possible. Listening to each other, the long, dramatic, contradictory account we give of a past made up of encounters and misunderstanding, of mutual help and continuous rivalry, often of a mimetic kind, so as to learn from mistakes, our sins, or deeds that deserve repentance, the best we can, while on the other hand taking heart in our achievements, and therefore growing. We may understand growth, not so much in terms of accumulation of wealth and power and glory and technical knowledge, but rather in terms of building a character, finding some guidance to do so, and choosing a way among the many ways our, let's call it, educational ancestors have suggested, and then taking a stand. For instance, a stand not to confuse magnanimity with a restless ambition to be top of the world no matter how. Choosing the Pascalian wager instead of a Faustian bargain, a Pascalian bet, or maybe a Proustian one. We may consider learning and understanding the Proustian way as we define Proust's character by a continuous, endless rumination and oscillation between past and present that fosters intelligence as well as care for others, intense curiosity as well as empathy, lucidity and a rejection of the indifference as a summum of cruelty towards others. The world being perceived as composed of potentially significant others, to start with people closest to us, and then reaching out to people of more remote places and times, in the expectation that maybe people would listen with a significant doses of curiosity and empathy, listening in a spirit of charity, trying to understand what the others mean by what they say, instead of letting ourselves go onto a war path of endless either winning or losing. Winning or losing what? The answer must depend on how do we define the good things in life. Quite often, these good things in life refer to power, wealth, glory, and, say, pretenses of magical or technical omniscience. And as such, they are taken for granted. Or well, on the contrary, these good things may be considered the usual suspects of the ways of the world, which have been exposed and questioned in various moral languages, at least since axial times. This questioning being always somehow there. Here, a note of caution may be required. Understanding life as it is, and not as it merely ought to be, requires also a sense of reality that allows room for expecting a dosis of the passions of hubris and rapacity, of vanity and mania of indoctrination, which have been and are part of the human experience so far, and which demonstrate that the virtue or moral goodness available to humans has its limits. This is a note of caution the European moralists of the 17th century knew all too well, and that our experience of the last three centuries after the Enlightenment doesn't alter the fundamentals of this conclusion so far. The next point is to reckon with another fact of life, the pervasive experience of people dealing with multiple realities. Priority being given to one or other of these identities oscillates according to circumstances, subject to a near continuous inner dialogue of people who feel to be members of several groups all at the same time. Humankind, we may say, has a very extended experience of dealing with multiple realities. In the case of being Europeans and members of a nation state, survey data tell us once and again that about 2/3 of Europeans, up to 4/5 of several countries, in several countries, feel being both members of a given nation and Europeans. And it's been this way for a very long time. The fact is they live their dual experience as being part of a natural order of things, nothing to feel strange or uneasy about. This applies to all sorts of people having a feeling of being Europeans, to ordinary people whose local experience far exceeds their contact with the rest of Europe, as well as to the elites of all sorts, to politicians usually obsessed with the control of local politics, to business people eager to cultivate close links with local authorities and local markets, to publishers and writers and academics most attentive to their local cultural linguistic markets, etc., etc. All this reflects a long, widespread experience that includes a long period of, say, coexistence between empires and regional authorities of the more distant past, the time of the quasi-modern or modern states set on a game of countless conflicts and uneasy mutual accommodations, and then, just in the last century, a much too terrible experience when intense conflict evoked the possibility of utter mutual destruction, at least twice, followed by 70 or more years of quote-unquote peace and prosperity in West Europe, and about 30 years of something similar shared by the East. The very contrast between war and peace, making for a prolonged modus vivendi and the apparent normalcy of an endless maintenance of the current statu quo. As a result of which, most of us today have become used to live a sort of rather harmonious dual identity and engage in a rather peaceful inner dialogue concerning both identities. But besides, this relatively recent experience comes in the framework of a broader narrative that displays the symbolisms of country, nation, Heimat, homeland, patrie, in a way that reflects the view that the nation is unthinkable out of the context of Europe, not just here and now, but in the long durée. Unthinkable out of the whole system of European nations as loosely connected entities, as confederations, as empires, etc., being the European Union another avatar in a series of mutations of that system, wherein the nation transcends the rather narrow experience of just contemporary and modern times, which tend to overplay the differentiated character of each nation. While in fact, even the crucial moments of putting the nation first can try to obscure, but cannot avoid pointing at the fundamental fact that being just the first of many others make us dependent on the others' recognition. And this suggests a record of a very complex, ambiguous mix of experiences and symbolisms to live with. France, for instance, as a historical reality, embodies a very complex symbolism that connects its current commitment to an open society, universalist values, to a very specific identity with a sense of a national mission rooted in a remote past. Linking the symbolisms of the Holy Land and the France of Saint Jean d'Arc, all through the Enlightenment to the Enlightenment and the French Revolution, not to mention the symbolisms of Le Roi Soleil and Bonaparte, with an army sustaining and embodying their desire for grandeur and for being the center of the world, ready to take the lead of Europe anytime, without ever neglecting their own protagonism. And of course, France has not been and is not alone in this endeavor. Many European nations have seen themselves as bearers of extraordinary projects, as providential nations, especially favored by some divinity. Hence, their national or patriotic stand, usually having a deep religious, crypto-religious dimension, for reasons that seemed profound and sensible to many reasonable people at the time. I would say Spain, of course, England, Germany, Austria, Sweden, Hungary, Poland, the Netherlands, Portugal, Denmark, Italy, Rome, Greece, all of them at some point, expansionists by land and by sea and with the help of God, and defenders of their ancestors' legacy and of their true faith, as a wall of containment against godless invaders, challenging the very existence and the essence of the whole Europe. To sum up, a binary interpretative frame posing Europeanist and nationalist against each other distorts the symbolisms and experience by means of which most people all over Europe try to make sense of their dual identity. As it questions both its European component and its national component, which is impossible to understand unconnected from Europe. On top of this, such binarism reduces the strategic capacity of both Europe and its constituent nations to cut down the risk of drifting toward the sort of chaos I referred to at the beginning of this exposé, as it questions the culture of conversation and friendship which is needed, adding confusion to the European debate on the management of all sorts of issues, of course, including the socioeconomic issues. We tend to be seen by Europeans or by many Europeans in terms of confronting irreconcilable positions, while in fact these positions, left and right, may be in practice not so incompatible and maybe not so fundamental, as people could say. On the contrary, the development of a culture of conversation in all its dimensions, political as well as economic, social, and cultural, check the drift towards forms of capitalism or a market economy functioning by remote control unintelligible for most ordinary people, apparently leading to precariousness and inequality and dispossession of the many. The drift towards a democracy leaning towards partitocracy and oligarchy and populism. The drift of society becoming an aggregate of self-centered interest groups and identity groups. And the drift to a cultural milieu becoming a Babel Tower with everyone trying to impose its own version of what may seem to him or to her politically correct or morally correct. Europe is once again in a critical crossroads. Much depends on its capacity to remember and to reckon with not only its limits, but also its potential to listen, and then thus nurture a space of friendship, both inside Europe and towards the rest of the world. Avoiding the worst of the current binarism of globalist versus localist, Europeanist versus nationalist, learning from its past mistakes to handle its complex identities, contradictory narratives, and changing socioeconomic arrangements. Making the best of our dramatic past, trying to be not the center of the world, but just helping the world to stay alive and being one of the many witnesses, shepherds to the world, thinking and caring as long as it takes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.